Perovskites are often hailed as the next big thing for solar panels. They're more efficient than silicon photovoltaics could ever be, and they have higher yields. However, their fragility and short lifespans have relegated them to the lab so far. But 2024 is looking to be the year of perovskite. The last few months have seen new perovskite researchers all over the world smashing records, including durability. Because of this, some of these new perovskites are even set to hit the market this year. So let's check out some of the most exciting breakthroughs in the field and see for ourselves if perovskites are finally ready for their big debut. And why should you even care? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Opera, but more on that later. It truly feels like we're at the beginning of a massive paradigm shift for solar. Researchers are breaking so many different perovskite records using such widely varied techniques just within the last few months, it's kind of mind-blowing. Some teams are coming at this from a chemistry angle, trying to engineer tougher perovskites. Others are looking at the very architecture of a perovskite photovoltaic cell, experimenting with understudied cell blueprints and achieving surprising results. Now then there's those who have random eureka moments that make for great science stories, when making one little change causes everything to fall into place. There's just so many wild advances all happening at once. With so many discoveries, it stands to reason that there's hope for at least some of them to reach the market. Let's back up for a second though. What are perovskites? We've talked about them before on the channel, so here's a quick TLDR. They're a family of crystalline materials with the same crystal structure as calcium titanate. Now, current silicon solar cells only capture around 20% of usable sunlight, meaning they're leaving around 80% on the table. Perovskites have the potential to use more of that sunlight, and many easily break that 20% figure. They might be able to break silicon's theoretical maximum efficiency of 29%. Better yet, they can be tuned to capture light from parts of the spectrum that silicon PVs just can't touch. Now, this is good news on its own merits, and it allows you to kind of Voltron perovskite and silicon layers together to form a tandem cell that captures much more light than either could on their own while sharing the same footprint. Now, to sweeten the deal even further, perovskites are also relatively easy to synthesize and produce. And to give you an idea of just how big of a deal increasing solar panel efficiency is, we can take a look at my own home as a point of comparison. I have REC 400 watt panels on my house, which have a rated efficiency of about 21.6%. With 4 hours of sun a day, a single REC 400 panel would generate about 576 kilowatt hours a year. Now these are high level calculations and don't take local conditions, inverter hardware, angle, all that kind of stuff into account. Now upping that efficiency with the same exact single panel footprint to something like 25% might not sound like a big jump, but would produce about 682 kilowatt hours a year. That's a 15% jump in overall output. That would mean instead of needing something like 30 REC panels to achieve my energy goals at 21.6% efficiency, I'd only need 25 panels at 25% efficiency. So what's the catch? Well, cost usually is the issue with these sorts of things, but not here. Believe it or not, perovskites aren't prohibitively expensive. In fact, easy manufacturing techniques and widely available materials mean perovskites can be cheaper than silicon PVs. That means in my hypothetical example, I would not only need fewer panels to achieve my goals, they'd theoretically be cheaper per panel too. No, the real issue is their durability. While they've performed very well in lab conditions, perovskite cells degrade very quickly out in the real world. Some can see a capacity dip as large as 80% in 2 years or less. Now compare that to my REC 400 panels with a 25-year warranty that guarantees only about an 8% dip by the end of the warranty. What's killing perovskite cells so fast? Well, heat, moisture, oxygen, and even UV rays. You know, all the things that solar panels are gonna have to face day in and day out. We can't slather our solar panels in a nice coat of sunscreen, so the benefits we mentioned a minute ago are effectively locked behind the durability problem. And that's why finding a solution to it has become something like a holy grail of solar tech.
There's only one way to find out.
That brings us to the big question, has anyone made any progress solving this problem, or are perovskites a dead end? And if they are, what other pathways are there to solar advancement? Well, good news, the UK-based company Oxford PV returns to this channel yet again, and this time they've solved the perovskite durability issue. So what do you think? Jump in the comments and let me know. No, I'm just kidding, don't click off, the video's not over. It is true that Chris Case, Oxford PV's chief technology officer, told the Wall Street Journal that the company's cells are designed to meet or beat a 25-year lifespan. Oxford PV says it's proved this by studying full-size modules in outdoor environments for over 3 years, then used that data to predict long-term stability. These studies also show that its best tandem cells lose only about 1% efficiency in their first year of operation and have a very small rate of decline thereafter. Now, frustratingly, these results have yet to be published, but that could be for proprietary reasons. I mean, after all, if you're the only one who's cracked the tough perovskite code, there's gonna be a lot of value in that. Now, that said, Oxford PV is making definite progress. It's teamed up with the Fraunhofer Institute for Solar Energy Systems in Germany, which recently used Oxford PV's tandem cells to construct a working solar module. Now, the Fraunhofer Institute just announced that this module achieved a record-breaking 25% conversion efficiency. Now, remember what that could mean based on my calculations earlier, about a 15% increase in power output over a year. Now that the efficiency is confirmed, the Fraunhofer Institute and Oxford PV are working towards certifying that all-important longevity stat. Now, to this end, they're putting the module through a battery of intensive long-term stability tests. And while it pays to be skeptical about these sorts of breakthroughs, I should note that Oxford PV's factory in Brandenburg, Germany is set to begin commercial production of their tandem solar cells later this year. So if all goes according to plan, we won't have to wait too long to put them to the test. They aren't the only group with interesting progress, but before we get into those, it can get a little overwhelming as my team and I research these topics. There's so much news and research to sift through that I get lost in the browser tabs a lot. Well, today's sponsor, Opera, has been a huge help with this. I really love using workspaces to keep personal tabs separate from work tabs when pulling together research. It really is easy to flip back and forth between those groups. I've also really been loving Tab Islands, which automatically consolidates related tabs together into groups. This one was kind of an eye-opener for me. For instance, as I was diving between articles on different perovskite advancements, Opera automatically keeps those tabs together in an island. I don't know about you, but I often get lost in a sea of tabs, and this really helps me out. I also really like the sidebar, which keeps things like my social media accounts one click away in a nice slide-out window. But the thing I found myself using a lot in the sidebar is Aria. Sometimes I come across a paper in another language and can quickly translate a section of that article with the help of Aria, or ask for a quick summary of an article to see if I'm heading down the right path quickly. And finally, I love how easy it is to screen capture a section of a web page or article, or even the full web page itself, for use in a Notion ticket for my team to reference later. Opera really has helped me streamline some of my workflow. If you'd like to try out Opera for yourself, check out the link in the description. Thanks to Opera for supporting the channel, and thanks to all of you, as well as all my patrons who get early ad-free versions of my videos. So back to who else is making good progress in perovskites. In other developments, an international group of scientists led by the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology in Saudi Arabia are taking a different approach to perovskites. Rather than focusing on making better materials, they're optimizing how we assemble those materials for maximum energy generation and efficiency. You see, one of the main limiters of solar cell efficiency is the mobility of its charge carriers. And charge carriers are the electrons and the holes that are knocked free from their homes inside the cell by incoming solar energy. The movement of electrons is, by definition, electrical current. Holes are places where the electron could go, so their movement is really the movement of electrons as well. It's actually these charge carriers that we use to create the flow of electricity, not the sunlight itself. That's an oversimplification in the interest of time, so if you want to know more, check out some of my other solar panel videos where I describe how it works. Now, anyway, part of what makes perovskites so efficient is that they allow those charge carriers more mobility than they can get in silicon cells. Even still, the majority of these carriers are usually captured by the material that they're conducting through or defects within the cell long before they can reach the electrodes to be used as electricity. It's not great. Now, this has led some engineers to add an extra layer to the cells to help facilitate the capture of those charge carriers. Solar cells have a P layer, which is the home of the holes, or the N layer, which is the home of the electrons. The light capturing I layer of the perovskite sits between the two layers. This gives us two possible types of architecture depending on which layer you want the sunlight to touch first, the hole layer, which is PIN, or the electron layer, which would be NIP. Now, each architectural style has its strengths and its weaknesses, and explaining them all could be its own video. So to keep it brief, the electron-first NIP style is physically easier to construct, which means it's more common and better studied. It also helps that most of the efficiency records are currently held by Team NIP. But recent research suggests that PIN variants are much more durable than their counterparts, and some can even match the NIP's efficiency. This is where the Saudi researchers are making progress. They've developed a novel PIN setup with enhanced ligands. That's the stuff that bonds the perovskite to the other layers. It also acts as a kind of capstone or varnish on top of the perovskite layer to protect them. The result is a perovskite PIN cell with a very good power conversion efficiency of 25.63%. After 1,000 hours of testing at 85 degrees Celsius temperatures, which is about 185 degrees Fahrenheit, they only degraded by 5%. In yet another recent efficiency and durability breakthrough, a team led by scientists from the Korea Institute of Energy Research have broken records for semi-transparent perovskite PVs. They focused on semi-transparent perovskite cells because they show a lot of promise when used in window and bifacial PVs. Why? Well, a solar cell requires electrodes. For mechanical reasons, these electrode layers are best positioned in the outer part of the cells. It's like the bread of our solar sandwich. Now, of course, these electrodes aren't perfectly invisible, so they tend to block some of the light. As a result, they tend to only end up on one side of the cell. But what if we could make transparent electrodes? Well, we can. They've already been around for years. So why aren't all PVs equipped with transparent electrodes? Why aren't all windows doubling as perovskite cells right now? Well, here's the thing. Transparent electrodes cause PV cells to degrade much faster because they don't screen out high energy particles that damage the whole transport slash end layers, all that kind of stuff that we just talked about a minute ago. Now, Cure scientists fixed it by adding a metal oxide layer to screen out those particles, and they found even more efficiency and fewer degradation issues. The energy AI and computational science wing of the Cure team took a look at the data and discovered that the end layer was reacting unexpectedly with the metal oxide. Normally, lithium is added to the end layer to make it more conductive and improve efficiency. Well, it turns out the lithium ions were diffusing into that metal oxide blocker and making them both less effective. However, the Cure scientists found a pretty elegant solution. Lithium ions already oxidize into lithium oxide. Previously, the lithium oxide was assumed to be harmless byproducts of the process. The Cure team deliberately converted the flighty lithium ions into stable lithium oxide, and voila, enhanced durability and efficiency. Their semi-transparent solar cells hit an efficiency of 21.68%, making them the most efficient among the transparent perovskite electrodes in the world. Better yet, they retained 99% of their initial efficiency after 240 hours of operation, and their stability rating remained at 99% for 400 hours. Now, if you're curious about transparent solar cells, I've got a video that does a deeper dive on them that I'll link to in the description. But it's not all good news. We need to talk about Cubic PV. The company is backed by Bill Gates, and given his green tech investing record, it's up to you if that's a good thing or not. But just days after my 2023 solar panel update video was released, Cubic PV announced that thanks to incentives in the Inflation Reduction Act, or the IRA, it was going to build a 10 gigawatt conventional mono wafer factory. Now, this was set to fill a supply chain gap here in North America and create an estimated 1,500 green energy jobs. It's awesome. So what's the bad news? Well, Cubic PV recently announced it's shifting to tandem perovskite cells instead, abandoning the wafer factory in the process. Now think about that. A major company ran the numbers and was so confident that perovskite tandem cells were the future that it abandoned silicon wafer plans midstream. Surely it's a promising sign for the future of perovskites, but definitely not great for the community that was looking forward to the previous promise of a bunch of good green jobs. Now, another thing about Cubic PV, it's claiming to have tackled perovskite's durability issues through, quote, better chemistry and by building intrinsic stability into the material itself. There's no further data on how their company is planning on doing this, which doesn't give me very much confidence, but given that they're working on a proprietary method to manufacture a lot of perovskite cells in a fast, cheap, and energy efficient manner, it is possible that Cubic PV's perovskite chemistry is proprietary too. Great if it comes to fruition, but again, I'm remaining a little bit skeptical until I see some hard evidence. So perovskites remain the solar MacGuffin, but it does feel like we're making some real progress here. If just one of these companies has truly solved the durability issue, we could be on the cusp of a solar revolution. The market certainly seems to think we're on our way. The global perovskite solar cell market size was just about 94.8 million in 2022. It's expected to balloon to around 2.479 billion by 2032. Even if these predictions are wrong and they're not the next technological leap in the solar sphere, their efficiency ratings are so impressive, they'll probably find their niche no matter what. But what do you think? Do you think perovskites are gonna live up to the hype? Would you want them? Jump in the comments and let me know. And before I go, I'd like to welcome new Supporter Plus patron, David Fain. Thanks so much for your support, and I'll see you in the next one.